Okay, it's really hard to follow your own students' talks because hers talk was brilliant, I thought. So I'm going to be talking about our 4D, so it's 3D, XYZ, and time of a growing minimal cell. And when I say it's an integration of theory and experiments, if you look at many of the names that are up there as co-authors and co-workers on this project, they are experimentalists. So from Harvard, we now have Tae Kip Ha and his postdoc doing the imaging. The cell was made at the JCVI Institute in San Diego. Elizabeth Vila did the tomograms. John Stone helps us with all the imaging. And in the Netherlands, I can't believe it, I have three or more coworkers, collaborators there, Marek, and then, well, Eric, Swedish, but they help us when we go and do the back mapping to the all atom. Ramos Dame did the high C maps of it. And Case Decker was giving us his experimental information and models how to do the DNA segregation using the SMC loops. And then finally, the lipidomics is done by James Sense at the Technical University in Dresden. And Julia Mohammed comes in as one of our team leaders in our new STC system and is helping us as we go further in and start looking at eukaryotic systems. So let me get started because I have 40 slides. I have to speak one a minute. That is the map of the minimal cell over there. That just shows the proteins for metabolism, genetic information processing. If you notice, there's only 493 genes, but only 452 code for proteins. It is about one-tenth in every dimension you can think of to E. coli, except for the part that's unclear. E. coli has over 5,000 genes, and 1,700 of them, they don't know what they do. I would not work on E. coli, and I quit when I saw that number and decided, oh, the minimal cell, I have a chance. And then along came AlphaFold. Aha. So now I have structures, even of the ones we don't know what they do. And that number is slowly getting smaller and smaller. And then you see all the people surrounding the cell. It is small. It's, we from the tomograms, we see that it ranges anywhere from about 400 to 600 nanometers. The metabolism is greatly reduced. You have to bring in everything to the cell. And everything, I mean, like nucleosides, fatty acids, the amino acids. The genetic information processing is pretty much the same. But if you go and I guess this, I have nowhere to point. The essential metabolism of this thing, you can write it down on one page. I didn't say you could read it. But you certainly can write it down on one page. And this was even too much for some of the physicists and biophysicists that were in my group. So everybody got their own metabolic pathway to study. And then the map itself had been made already back in 2019. And I think I failed to say that all those citations at the bottom of the previous slide show the papers that we wrote when we went after each of the subcellular networks in the cell. So everybody, the map itself had been done by Marion Breuer, who's now a professor over here in the Netherlands. And then everybody else got their own system, and we had to come up with the kinetic parameters. We used machine learning there. The main kinetic database for biochemical reactions is, of course, here in Germany, in Brenda, in Braunschweig. But the Americans just say Brenda because they can't say Braunschweig. But even if you use machine learning, you had better test that it has the right thermodynamic behavior. And the other thing, I always show this slide when there's a biochemist in the audience. I go, quit, teaching them only the Michaelis-Menten reaction. Almost everything in this cell requires at least two to three substrates and products. So we have to use, unless we know the order of the binding, and only in a few cases do we know it, you have to use the random binding model. And thank goodness Liebermeister and his colleagues have done a lot of work on that. And as I said, you can take the parameters that are out there. There's none for this particular organism, which was made upon the reduction of the Mycoplasma mycoides. So you have to use a Bayesian estimator to get initial estimates. But then as you modify them and look at the free energy drop down, say, the central glycolysis pathway, you have to be sure that you recapture that and get also the right agreement of what's irreversible or reversible in that. So, what are our initial conditions when we start our simulations? On the physical side, we're lucky we have like tomograms. That's Elizabeth's tomogram. If you're looking down on it, you go, oh my God, the ribosomes are everywhere. They're not on the outside or in the middle. So where do we put the DNA? That was a problem. So we placed it using a lattice DNA model. We came up with an ensemble of structures that we could use for different replicates. You add the membrane proteins up here. I think this is the pointer. Yes. And then we add all the rest of the proteins. And now we're ready to go. And as I said, we were fortunate. We had the Hi-C maps from Ramos-Dame. So that helped us in coming up with the configurations for the DNA. Now, I won't have much time to talk about the math that we do here. It is a hybrid reaction diffusion master equation when we want to do and exploit the full heterogeneity of the cell. So we have a reaction kernel and a diffusion kernel. The reaction kernel would look just like a chemical master equation. So these are the propensities to take things in and out, the state of a cell, and the P stands for the probability of a state, and X has everything in it that you're including in your model. And this, of course, this is what happens when you have a reaction that takes you out of that state, and this one is all the reactions that take you back into that state. And then you have a diffusion operator. And if you notice, all I've added here is when you're doing this in 3D, then you've divided your cell up into subvolumes, and then you have to sort of use the right excluded volume rules. If there are ribosomes there, and actually it could take over several of these subunits, or DNA, that's different excluded volume rules than what you have when you have just reactions taking place in them like you do here. All right, so we also developed this over the years, and perhaps for those coming more from physics, I would suggest that you go back and look at the reports in progress in physics. As I said, or the cell paper, we give the latest update there. Excuse me. Now, whenever you're mixing and have hybrid methods, you have to say how the two methods or three methods, excuse me, communicate with one another. So let's just say we have the ordinary differential equations, which we typically use for metabolism, because the numbers there are so high that the fluctuations are really not that interesting in nanomolar quantities. In the more micromolar and nanomolar range, you want to use the CME. So you could simulate for a certain while, and then you have to communicate to the ODE and then vice versa. And here are some typical things that you would be communicating. You know, the enzyme counts, the number of nucleotides used in transcription, the deoxynucleotides used in DNA replication. We have a degradosome, so we're recycling the mRNA all the time. And we wanted to keep an eye on the ATP cost, because again, I forgot to say when I showed you the main glycolysis pathway, that's the only place we get ATP. There's no oxidative phosphorylation in this cell. There's no photosynthesis. So that's it. And then to study the errors that we would make in that, we published a paper in 2018 in an IEEE journal on IET systems biology. And now let me show you just a first short movie. It's only over the 20 minutes of the first part of the cell cycle. It's at the fate of an mRNA. We're not going to have in those 20 minutes DNA replication or the cell growth. So we'll just concentrate on what happens to the messenger, and you're going to see the ribosomes are going to change color when that messenger reaches a ribosome and starts being translated, or when it reaches the degradosome, which is a complex, and starts being degraded. And the DNA, in this movie, we made them 12 base pairs to a bead, and you can flickering see the transcribing RNAP come about. So let's see, that movie should work. Yes, so if you just watch this again and again, and you do it for many of the different replicates with different configurations of the DNA, you'll soon see after a while, like if we just look up here, you'll see a ribosome perhaps has translated, changed color, translated the messenger. Oh, and now the messenger looked like it got maybe chewed up by the neighboring degradosome. So there is a competition between degradation and translation. And that really controls whether you're able to double the protein count over the host cell cycle. Now, that was only 20 minutes. And as I said, we didn't have the DNA replication in there and we didn't have the cell growth. It's taken us about a year to get there. But over those 20 minutes, we were able to get an idea about how many of the degradosomes become active, the polymerases are active, and the ribosomes become active. Now, it starts off, it looks like you have this transient because we started with all of them empty. One of the reviewers complained about it, but we wanted to see how long it took for diffusion to take place to get there and have the process start. But out of that, we already got an estimate of the mRNA half-life of all 452 protein-coding genes. We had we could come up with something, an estimate of how many proteins are translated per messenger RNA. Those all seemed reasonable when we compared it to that Bible of all data, either bio numbers or Dennis, and I think it's Dennis and Weaver. Now, we do want to move on to the entire 110-minute cycle and start gaining some insight into the minimal rules of life. So let me just review for you quickly what we need. An initial state to start with, so that means we have to have all the omics data possible. In that gene map I showed you, all the polygons were the same size because it just stood for the count, but the genes, but we also have that same map where they change size based on the proteomics. We know now the lipidomics. We have good estimates on the metabolomics and the transcriptomics, but the transcriptomics is still just being done, so we have not been able to completely check that, but we're trying to also do that experimentally using some fish experiments. And again, as always, we start with a tomogram, and then we have a DNA configurations that we place initially, and then we use kinetic data from every single molecule technique out there possible to get at the kinetics. Okay, you have all the cellular processes. Those were the reaction and diffusion kernels. So you have to come up with diffusion coefficients for many of these things. Again, that's why it's really important to get a handle on the subcellular dynamics. And then you have to have a methodology to do that. I explained we use this hybrid stochastic deterministic methods. Everything has to run on the best GPU, and sometimes just by getting the next best GPU, our code improves by a factor of 2. And we're now just getting geared up to run it on the new Grace Hoppers. So it looks like what is now taking is 10 days to do the entire cell cycle, that we may be able to do it in under a week, which would just be fabulous. So, and these are the type of data that you can get out of it. Everything from the messenger count and how it varies over the cell cycle to the amount of ATP costs that are used. So let me remind you as we go forward, just the problems that you have in balancing this. As I said, the cell has to bring in things like the nucleosides, both the deoxy and the normal ones. You can have recycling from the degradosomes. And everything has to be running properly so that you'll get the right number of RNAs, either to make the ribosomes or to make the messengers. In the same way over here, you have to be making the right number of deoxynucleotides so you can replicate the DNA. Now, most of the time when you talk to people who work with a natural bacteria, they never worry about the pool size. They say it takes care of itself. This cell, when they reduced it from Mycoplasma mycoides, almost all the regulation went out the door if it wasn't essential. So the pool size can get critical. And that means you can suddenly have a slowdown in replication or a slowdown in the transcription. So you do have to be aware of this. And to start with the DNA replication, we were really fortunate that we had the help of the key scientists at the Greg Venter Institute, Hamilton Smith. He was at the U of I, got a degree in mathematics from us, but decided he wasn't going to get the field prize in mathematics, switched into biology, and when he went out to Stanford or Berkeley, and then received the Nobel Prize or shared it for a discovery of restriction enzymes, which he proceeded to take out completely from the cell. So, but he had already a model of how DNA replication would start. And we were lucky that there were X-ray structures available from Berger at the Johns Hopkins. So it starts with the binding of a protein, DNA A, to the DNA, but it straddles the fork. So there's part of it that binds to 9 nucleotide signature on the double strand. And then there are 3 main binding sites here that I'll show you, 1, 2, 3. They're also in this picture here. But then once it sort of twists it open, there's another domain that binds to 3 nucleotides on the single-stranded part like this. And that's the underlying part here. So you can have a filament up to almost 30 long to open up the bubble and allow you to get the replisome machinery in there. So, and again, we're lucky somebody did single molecule FRET on the elongation of that filament. So we had the on and the off rates available to us. And then we borrowed a model from Hofmeier that was published in Phelps Letters for polymerization models for the DNA replication, transcription, and even translation, modified it slightly. You just have to keep identifying you have to identify what's the template, in this case, the single-stranded DNA for DNA replication, same way for transcription, and then the messenger for translation. What's the corresponding enzyme that's used, and what's the corresponding monomer that comes in there? And here's just a sort of a cartoon of the replication. And then when it's been copied, we then have two of the chromosomes there. We don't do anything fancy with the replication. We go from, you know, either we don't even excuse me, simulate the single-stranded portion of this, other than to count how many filaments we have, and then we immediately go over to the double-stranded version. Now, in our cell paper, we looked and compared it to experiments already done by qPCR of the origin to TER ratio. So here is the here is the TER, and here is the origin. And as you start forming forks, the ratio of origins to TER goes up. You can have a complete replication, and again, you can have multiple ones. So if you look over here, the experiment shows that it's around 3.2. In our simulations, we were getting a number that was smaller. What I'm showing you here, we're just done with only the CME version of the code at that time. And also, our error bars are much larger because we were only doing about 200 simulations at that time. The other thing we wanted to pay attention to was the ATP cost for every step that's along the cell cycle. And if you look at the top curve, keep doing this. Look at the top curve, the generation and the cost of the ATP just about cancel one another. And then two lines I want to draw your attention to. This one, because there's so much ATP that's used to pump things into the cell, one didn't have a good estimate of what its cost would be, and it's pretty high. And then the other thing that I thought was interesting, because it just had a unique shape, was the replication. Here's the case of one replication. This one started at about 30 minutes. Sometimes it's down here more like 15 minutes. It's very variable in this system. And here's the case when you have multiple replication events. All right, now again, we also use information from molecular dynamics simulation. This was a student, former student of my husband, Gumbart, and where he looked at the assembly of the translocase and then the ATP cost and the speed at which you can read in the membrane protein. Those two went into that picture that I showed you. And then I bring this up just before I look at how the surface area and volume changes. So this is not an agent-based model. Everything that we put in here comes from a reaction. We're very proud of this, and this took us a long time to do this. So in this minimal cell, you're coming in with the fatty acids and has the ability to make two lipids, PG or the cardiolipin, which is, you know, double it. It also can absorb from the outside sphingomyelin and also even PC. And we knew the composition that we had compared to its parent from the Dresden lab of James Sense. And this was the lead technician also at the Greg Venter Institute. And this was my student who did all this modeling here to come up with the growth rate. Because that at the end is what determines how our volume changes and how the surface area changes over the entire cell cycle. Now, we did several runs, so that's why you're seeing the shading, these 200 cases, again, just from the CME so far. And we felt that after it doubles its volume, it should be starting a symmetric cell division. we had a reason of assuming that. It's not clear that it should be that. We can also, if you'll take a look, you have to, in calculating the surface area, you have to take into account not only the area due to lipids, but also those due to the membrane proteins to get the total surface area. When we did that, we saw that we got a sort of a range of doubling times, and here's the experimental value that's made. There's a certain error, I would also say, that's in that, because they do it mostly by counting the DNA and not necessarily by optical density, as most people, as many labs do. But again, as I said, we felt pretty good about this. These are all predictions of what would happen as we add really diffusion in here. Now, when we did the 20 minutes, we did try to learn from those curves probability factors that we put into the CME simulation so we could get as close to a reality as possible. Most of them were pretty good, but so the parameters that we use now to do the full cell cycle in 3D, they didn't change much from the cell paper. A few, and particularly the balance between the degradation rate of binding to the degradasome and the ribosomes did change a bit, because otherwise over the whole cell cycle, we really were not doubling the protein number as in all cases. So why we had assumed we more or less had symmetric cell division was because of the work of Tae Kip Ha and this really gifted postdoc, Ji Wong. Actually, the cells were finally grown by a colleague of mine, Angad Mehta at the U of I, and he would just fly in and use our excellent imaging facilities at the Institute of Genomic Biology. So we were able to label the DNA, the membrane, and the FTSZ. So this is early on in the cell cycle. And then this is what we saw later. So it does look like symmetric cell division. I mean, if you go and measure it, yes, one side looks a little bigger than the other. But as as a theoretician, we wanted to assume more or less that it's going to be symmetric. We did not have a good model for the formation of the septum. FTSZ requires about four other proteins to do this, and we still haven't worked it out. We get it to bind, but we can't get it to treadmill at the moment. So instead, what we did, we assumed this the symmetry, and we know the growth rate now from our lipid metabolism. And what we now use is, for one of the movies that I'll show you, is a Helfrich-Hamiltonian, which has been developed over, my God, 50 years or more. And in particular, we use the newest version that was developed by Pazeskian. He's at the University of Copenhagen. So we can apply this Hamiltonian, and it gets updated from the lipid metabolism on the area to surface area to volume ratio, so with that we can grow the cell and get it to start dividing. Now, this was our first attempt, so you'll notice everything now is unpublished, actually even including the imaging, because we're even collecting more data as we go along. But in this movie, what we're gonna see is just the ribosomes and the degradasomes, and we're gonna watch the cell start growing, it should double, and then it should start converting over to this prolate form. Here we have the transition a little bit too fast. As you see, we don't get it quite symmetric. So here's the volume and the surface area. So it's growing. And now it's, the transition a bit fast. So we slowed that down, sampling more. But you can see the cell on the right is going to end up being slightly larger than the one on the left. That Helfrich-Hamiltonian is solved using a Monte Carlo technique. So you'll see it sort of wobbles in the solution as you go through this process. But we now at least have doubled the surface area, and it should be able to pinch off. Now, we had to quit using the lattice DNA model in these simulations because it took, frankly, too long. So instead, what we did, we came up with a polymer model, sort of motivated by the work of Brackley already from 2014, where it's now it's 10 base pairs to a bead. So here's the typical Hamiltonian. It has all the terms, like for bending, twisting, stretching. You can put in supercoiling. But from Ramus Dehm's work in Leiden, we saw that there was very little, if any, persistent supercoiling in this system. And in part, it had to do with the reduction from the mycoides down to the SYN3A. They had inadvertently chopped off a little bit too much of the control statement in when they removed one gene, and that affected how many of the HU proteins we got. We have 25. It needs to have about 2,000 of them. So it doesn't really, can't really stabilize the supercoiling correctly. So we didn't put that in here. We also have excluded volume terms that we added. So it has to be self-avoiding, but also avoiding of the ribosomes, which are now pink here. So we published the DNA model just recently, the setting up the host cell model from the tomograms we'd done in an earlier paper. And when I say we have additional problems that pop up, because now as you grow and replicate the DNA, we have the problem of entanglement. So how do you disentangle the DNA? Well, you need two proteins, and thank goodness they're essential proteins in the minimal cell. They could not eliminate these. One is the SMC, and it acts as a dimer, as you see here. And the other one is the topoisomerase. So let's say the SMC loops bind here or here. What they do through the work that was done by measured by Decker and then the model in Micheletto is that it sort of pulls through these loops, right? But then you're going to eventually have this problem where it's entangled here. And that's where the topoisomerase has come in to help break those bonds and then reassemble it. Well, as theoreticians, we just weaken the potential and let the thing pass through. And in this earlier paper that came out this summer, we were showing what ratio of looping and topoisomerases do we have in order to be able to segregate and replicate the DNA. All right, so I'm gonna show you a quick movie on the full ribosome of the SYN3A from here. If you look at the coloring, the mother is in these colors starting from blue to yellow. And when it forms the daughter, it's gonna be in various shades of gray. And so it has the looping as well as the topoisomerases. So we'll take away the ribosomes because it's hard to see. We'll show you once the origin in the TER, right? And now it starts replicating. And in this movie, and we didn't change the volume here, it was able to do about half of the genome was copied. If you notice, since we're doing 10 base pairs per bead, it's 54,000 beads. But we were able then, as I said, with these types of studies to replicate the entire genome, but you do need to be slowly increasing the volume. All right, so you get an idea. It's looking very clustered here and it is getting separation. When we were finished with expanding it, we were in contact with our colleagues, Sievert Jan Marek and Eric Lindau, because we wanted to do a Martini-Gromax study on it. And in fact, Sievert Jan has done that. In fact, he has a very large ERC grant on the minimal cell. So we took our polymer model, they put it into the Martini model, and we compared some of the dynamics. And it does have the same anomalous diffusion in both cases. So there's our polymer model. The alpha is about the same as what you're seeing over here when you put it in the Gromax model. That also forced Eric to change Gromax so that we could now be able to simulate the entire cell, which if you do it at the Martini level is 500 million particles. And if you want to do it the all atom, it's going to be 2 billion. So let me show you now. This was our first test case on trying to do the same simulation, but now including the DNA. This is a toy model. We wanted to be sure that first we could do that. So it's a much shorter genome. As you can see, the numbers at the bottom of each picture here are indicating the parameter that's used in the Helfrich-Hamiltonian. And it is changing and you're re-optimizing as you go through this whole process. And right now, good, they separate. but it's a little bit too fast for my taste. Although it's hard from any of the imaging results that you see, it's just a blue blob. So you can't really see the variation in the density to know, well, just how much is really, and where is it in this side of the cell or this side of the cell. So this was our attempt to do it, to grow the cell in 3D for the first 60 minutes. So we were able to track along with it the, not only the creation of new ribosomes, and we do have in here a complete ribosome biogenesis model that I had published already back in 2015 with Jamie Williamson, one of the experts at Scripps on the ribosome assembly and all the different ribosomal proteins. And as you can see, the replication sort of started over on this side. So the DNA is looking asymmetric, even though the cell is expanding. You can see now a little bit better the membrane proteins. I replaced the degradosomes now by the PTSG, which is the main transporter to get glucose into the cell. All right, so what about that last phase of really trying to, after you've doubled the volume, get it to be form these two dumbbell shapes? We have this information. The curves, and they were in the previous slide, are pretty much the same that we caught in the CME model. The other was a complete RDME, CME, ODE model. And how we're doing is this one. So it's still not perfect, but we're almost there. So we grow, and now it starts into the transition is slower. You're seeing the DNA. And these are the two origins here, and then one just got buried over here. But it's still not spreading out as fast as we would need to have it. It's a bit better, but it is next, still improvement. So that's why this is still in preparation. And we can stop at about any place in the cell now and give and create a model over here in lattice microbes. And then use all the structures that we know either from cryo-EM, NMR, X-ray, and AlphaFold 2 to go over here and turn it into a Martini model. And you can see much more nicely here the membrane proteins, and you can, here's just shadows in our latticeite for the membrane. As I said, 500 particles are needed here. We published as a prospective already in the beginning of this year that this could be doable, but nobody could simulate it until Eric changed GROMAX. That is now coming. And it is a real challenge because there are about 500,000 particles, particularly when you put in the water and the ions. These are the people that I really have to thank John Stone for visualizing both things. And that's Jan Stevens, a student with Marek Labs, that was able to set these simulations up. And now let me, I hope this might take a moment to show. When we have a cell state, a company here in Europe took our cell state and converted it into this very nice movie. You can see the membrane proteins here. So let me see if I can, okay. So he told me, oh yeah. It's a really big, oh boy. It's a really big video. So I have to be patient. And come on. And what you're going to see, so the membrane proteins are in purple. The membrane, the lipids, are all green, so we don't differentiate between the three or four different kinds that are there. But now pretty soon you're going to see this forest of green, and then you'll dive into the cell. And what I really liked about this movie is how good our DNA looked in it. So I'm very proud of this. And now in. So that's not an animation, that's from a real simulation. And those are the ribosomes and the structures are from the PDB database and put into the Martini shape in the Martini representation. So I think this is now going to be the wave of the future. You know, we can't show everything at once or you couldn't see anything. And so as we go forward, and for me, forward is now with this new science and technology center from the NSF, where we really do seek to give a quantitative description of all the physical and chemical processes in a cell that define it, and but want to do it as a function of time. So this should be true 4D simulations. And this is interesting. I pushed too fast. So the tools, it is a combined theoretical and computational center. So on the to get at the subcellular dynamics, we've purchased over a year ago a Minflux microscope. I think in America there are three. In Germany alone, there are eight. So that's why when I was here, I talked to Johannes Ries, who's really one of the experts of using the Minflux microscope. What can be labeled and tracked and what cannot be, even though you have, you know, a 0.1 millisecond resolution, which is 10 times better than anything else out there. And if you look at the spatial resolution, it's 2 nanometers in all X, Y, and Z directions. People still manage to label something that moves too fast. So membrane proteins, perfect. Kinesin walking on microtubules, perfect. Proteins binding to DNA, perfect, in all in that regime. And then in addition, we need more information as we go to even bigger systems about the metabolites. It's hard to label those. So we're trying to use a label-free method of in-cell IR microscopy. To do that, you're going to have to use machine learning to deconvolute that IR spectra region. It's very, very crowded. And the one of our group leaders is Rohit Bhargava. He's head of the Cancer Institute. So they're able to resolve at least the top 40 in different parts of the cell. And then one of our other group leaders on the cryo EM is Julia Mohammed from the EMBL. And she's helping us to interpret. They're also doing machine learning on all the systems. Hey, I didn't push that button. And so the whole idea is to combine these methods and bring it to life on a computer. And because we're NSF, we have to have an outreach that has to have an impact. And you'll see that in just a moment. So our impact is to bring ourselves into Minecraft. And we use all these methods. And the developers of each of those methods are also members of our STC. So it's like a dream team for me. Oop, I better get going. So here are the proud parents. That's my co-director, Martin Grubula, of our Minflux microscope. I was so disappointed when I opened up the lid and I go, we paid $1.3 million for this. You know, a lot of smoke and mirrors. And through the microscope, you're supposed to see great new cells. Instead, you see our logo and my minimal cell at the moment. But we've already had a workshop. And as I said, it took a lot of funding from various people, including I gave the last $25,000 to get this established here. So we're having a workshop next year in May. Please attend. And as we said, our minimal cell is sort of a proof of principle we could do this, but we'd already started several years ago working on eukaryotes. And so this was a paper that we published back in 2017 as a festschrift to my husband. So we start with the tomogram, and then we build up the slices, and from those, we build up a whole model. And we actually did some serious calculation on those. On the simulation of a galactose switch in E. coli. But now for the NSF STC, we're bringing that into Minecraft. And so you have to pretend maybe you're that sugar that comes in to the cell and binds to the repressor on the galactose transporter gene. And okay, the transporter looks like stairs at the moment, but it's going to stay that way because the kids like it, evidently. And it's sugar can diffuse around. There's the mitochondria. I always think it's interesting that in this particular tomogram, the vacuole is as big as the nucleus. Eventually, you go in through one of the nuclear pores, and then they can put the DNA in there. And we're hoping at least we'll get the kids interested in learning all the biology and about reactions. At least that's our plan. Although when I showed it to Case Decker, the only thing he asked me was, what can I shoot at, Zan? So I don't know. Maybe his kids will do a better job. So with that, I want to thank, I have to thank all these people who helped make this cell project possible. We're still not completely there, but I think by Christmas, we hopefully have done and gotten the DNA to separate as I think it should, but you know, it should be seeing is believing, not the other way around. But as I said, really a fantastic group of people are helping with this project. And thank you for your attention.